fresh and exciting for yourself, which is a reminder I think we all need occasionally. Well, those are my videos.
Was it just me, or did it feel like Annie left out post-production? Well, I'm here to fix that. And with me being a pretty technical person, this is gonna be a pretty technical list, so buckle up. In no particular order, here are my 7 post-production videos that helped me the most. Number 1, how professional editors set up a timeline by Film Editing Pro.
Okay, so here we have our editing timeline. Let's begin with V1 and we'll work our way up. So here we have video layers 1, 2, 3, and 4. These are the workhorse layers, where most of the picture editing will be happening. This is where you'll be adding all your footage to craft the scene. You'll also be using these layers for adding simple effects from your editing software. That might include picture resizes, keyed effects, wipes, fades, dissolves, and on and on.
Every edit involves a timeline, and this video really opened my eyes to how the pros do it. How, from the very beginning, they set it up so that they'll have everything they need in the order that they need it. I got the most out of the section about the audio tracks. That's the one main area I struggle the most to keep organized, even on my small projects. I refer back to this video a lot when starting new projects. And if you use Premiere Pro, a great place to start is with the Vashi template files. I'll put a link in the description. Number 2, Freddy's Keyboard Shortcuts for Editing by Rocket Jump Film School.
And the reason why I do that here is, one, Z is easy to remember, but also this keeps everything on the left side of the keyboard. The most sort of used commands are all on my left hand. So here, Z is just my pinky or my ring finger, punching in, punching out, and I can just go in like this. And again, I'm not hunting all over the keyboard for it, it's all just underneath my hand. The other thing, I use ANS for jump to previous edit and jump to next edit. And what they'll do is it'll go to the next edit points that it finds. So now,
I'm a sucker for new hotkeys, and the way Freddy explains his thought process behind his shortcuts was a game changer for me. After finishing this video, I immediately went and started messing with my own shortcuts. I'm at least twice as fast at editing as I was, and I continue to use the principles that he lays out in this video. I did use their template file from their description, but I've been messing with it so much that mine are totally customized to me. I highly recommend you go check it out. Number 3, The 7 Laws of Film Editing by This Guy Edits.
Vashi Nidomensky ACE is the guy who created the 7 commandments to become a better editor. Alright, so number 1 is watch every frame of raw footage at least twice, then start.
I think the only way to become comfortable with the footage is to watch it. I'll sit there for 4 hours, watch it at real time. The first time is literally just a visceral experience, just to let it wash over you. You have to live that footage before you can start editing. If you just go to circle takes and start building a scene, you're doing a huge disservice, not only to yourself, but to the film, to the director, to the actors, to everyone.
This is a really good video for understanding the job of the editor in its entirety. It touches on everything, from the way that you need to think about your edit to some best practices for organizing footage, and even how to relate with your director. I find a lot of value in understanding the whole scope of the task at hand, because as a self-taught editor, I may have missed or haven't even heard of all the things that I need to be thinking about. So having someone so clearly lay it out all in one place is kind of a dream. Number 4, The Ultimate Guide to Multicam Editing Part 1 by Film Editing Pro.
First important thing to know about multicams versus merged clips is the amount of footage and audio you can combine. With merged clips, you can combine one video source and as many audio sources as you want. This means if you were filming with one camera and multiple audio sources, such as a boom microphone, a lavalier, and the on-camera audio, you can combine all of that audio together with one source of video. But if you were filming with 2 or more cameras, such as working on a scene with many characters at once, or conducting an interview or filming a music performance, you would not be able to merge all of those video clips together.
This super specific entry is on the list because of how much I wished I had watched it before editing a feature film. Go check out Match Made at Christmas on Amazon, by the way. While sorting and syncing hours of footage, my worst fear was to find out too late that I had messed up in some irreversible way, and I would lose work or even have to re-edit later down the line. This video clearly lays out the comparison between 2 audio syncing methods in Premiere helping the viewer make the right choices for their projects. And believe me, having made the wrong choices, this is a lifesaver. Just in case any of you need this right now, please go check it out. You're welcome. Number 5, How Dialogue Should Sound by This Guy Edits.
Here's what we do. Since we know that the human voice makes no sounds really under 100 hertz, even James Earl Jones doesn't pull that one off, and the male voice starts at around 150, and the female voice starts at around about 200 or so, we're going to sweep up from about 100 hertz all the way up to about 5,000 hertz to see if we can find frequencies that just poke out, that are just too loud, and they'll sing to us, believe it or not. It'll be like a kind of a weird noise, and you'll hear it in a moment. We'll find those, we'll reduce them significantly in the hopes that we will be able to balance out and get a nice flat response from the recording itself.
I love the technical knowledge shared in this video. It may seem simple, but it has been very useful. My biggest challenge with audio is the human voice, and just having someone knowledgeable point me in the right direction is super valuable in my opinion. The information shared in this video is practical, and at least for me, helps to achieve the audio quality that you're hearing right now. I will say that the video is a little longer than it needs to be. I usually skip to about the 2-minute mark to get to the good stuff. Number 6, Save the Cat Beat Sheet, Interstellar Explained by Studio Binder.
Blake Snyder's Save the Cat Beat Sheet details 15 critical story beats that span a 3-act structure. Good structure has a huge effect on a film's success. So let's see how Interstellar stacks up against the beat sheet. Let's begin with the first beat, the opening image. This is our introduction to the world, and a counterpoint to the final image. A thoughtful opening image has the potential of establishing an overarching message, and a powerful way to preface a bookend for a film. In Interstellar, the opening image is a dormant symbol for hope, and a personal, forlorn desire. Remember this moment. We'll see how it comes back around in the end.
This video is based off just one of the chapters from the highly reviewed screenwriting book, Save the Cat by Blake Snyder. And you may ask, what do screenwriting concepts have to do with post-production? And I'll answer, knowing the beats of your story as the editor is super important. Annie had actually been trying to get me to read this chapter in the book Save the Cat, but I just watched this video instead. I love how they use the example of Interstellar to explain how this format of beat sheet works. I can't wait to use this method on my next film. Number 7, The Sound of Doom, a featurette by the Soundworks Collection.
Okay, we built this whole thing up, and then this big wave of sand comes across, which has the spice in it that's gonna overtake him. And it's a big frequency roll off that Doug did. It's a great trick. It goes like that. And it just, we just sucked everything out. So it's like really pulling the rug out. And then I took all of the more ethereal musical elements and spin them around the room. And then in comes all these Bene Gesserit voices and layers of that that are, I put all sorts of delays and the delays are spinning. And it's just to make him feel like, you know, if you're overwhelmed by something like that, you're going to be disoriented. It's one of my favorite sequences in the movie.
This video and many others like it on the Soundworks Collection YouTube channel have opened my eyes on how you can use sound design to deepen the meaning and impact of a film. This one in particular because of the inclusion of the director in the interview footage, talking about how he was a major part in crafting the soundscape of his film Dune. Besides just being awesome, it gave me insight into how to develop a vision for the soundscape of a film, or just how to help on someone else's vision. Number 8. There is no number 8, it was in the title. For editing a feature film. Yeah, one more good take.